I used the word, and I apologize to the people who watched the reaction, I used the word intricate about 18 times. But the guitars, I thought, were very intricate. Everybody, and welcome to another episode of the Audiophiles. My name's John, his name's Andy, and we are going to chow down on some awesome tunes. Andy, what have you got in the pipeline for me?
Well, we're going to revisit something that I've put you onto in the past, and it's an album that I just absolutely adore, and it's off the album 13th Step, which I think, as you like to call it, the slug face album or something to that effect. But it is...
You won't believe this. Uh-huh. It's a true story. I downloaded that album because I thought it was about time. And as I think, you know, we were discussing today, I had quite a long road trip and it was in the car, fired up, ready to listen to. And I didn't get around to it.
Oh, shoot. So that's good.
I could have listened to this song today because it was on the album, but I didn't. You know, we had too much fun grooving away to Jamiroquai.
Well, I can't blame you. Jamiroquai is pretty awesome, too. So, but yeah, and this would have set a completely different mood than Jamiroquai would have. So you're probably better off. Awesome to hear that you downloaded it, though. I'm glad that you've liked previous tracks off it enough to give it a go.
I thought I should listen to the whole goddamn thing. Yeah. Right. So yeah, this is great.
Cool. Well, then all that being said, to the listening audience should probably know that what I'm referring to is A Perfect Circle. One of the projects by Maynard James Keenan. And the song off of it is called The Noose.
Okay.
So, yeah, not exactly the acid dance stuff that you guys were listening to earlier with a name like The Noose. But go ahead and give that a listen.
If it was like The Moose, then that probably would have.
Maybe. It would make more sense. But, yeah, go up and give it a listen. Let me know what you think of it.
Okay.
Cool.
Starting, he's going to hate me for saying this, but it was almost reminiscent of something off The Unforgettable Fire. All it needed was Edge's guitar coming in. Sorry. Nice start. I'll just come back a little bit to when he starts singing.
So glad to see you. Cloud. But I'm more than just a little curious how you're planning to go about making your amends to the dead.
I think I caught the lyrics. There's something about great to see you doing so well, and silent and something else. And then it said about not to pull your halo down, sorry. But I was curious about how we're going to make amends to the dead. Given this is off the album The 13th Step, it made me immediately think of AA. Making amends as part of one of the steps to the dead. I wonder if it's like recovering alcoholic has, you know, sorted himself out and he's doing so well. But maybe like drink driving or something killed someone. So how do you make up for that? Oh, this is way off the mark. That's what it put in my mind. The song's really intricate. The guitar parts, there's some lovely stuff going on before the sort of kicked in when he said to the dead. That was really nice. It's really draws you in because it's so, I mean, the drumming as well is just really intricate. It's not steady 4x4. I'm going to have to pull that back a little bit because that was really interesting.
But I'm more than just a little curious how you're planning to go about making your amends to the dead.
This isn't in your face, like musically, heavy riffs, power chords, any of that stuff. But it's so goddamn interesting. The guitar work is really intricate. I've said that loads of times. That's the word for today. And the drumming is like precise. He's not doing massive fills, but he's just doing really interesting patterns. And the bass comes to the fore. And I noticed actually, from the start, the first verse, it was that dreamy scape that you get on the amplifier. And then it became clearer. I don't know why, but it certainly did. The sound became a lot clearer and the bass came to the fore a lot more. And I'm really, really enjoying this. It's so interesting. Sorry.
Just a little curious how you're planning to go. making your amends to the dead.
Another sunny day in our perfect circles world. Cheery chat, but goddamn, it's interesting. That's a repeat listening song if ever I heard one. Awesome. Back to Andy.
And you're back, I see. You've made it. So, This is what? I think this is the third track off this album.
Yes.
Listen to. Okay. And that at least that I've recommended to you. So where does it fall? Do you like it? Do you not like it? How do you feel?
So I have to say beforehand, my expectations were quite high. Because of the two tracks, it was that cheerful little one about someone turning blue and dying in front of his eyes, which, you know, as a thigh slapper tune if ever I heard one. And of course the spy who loved me or whatever it was, that Austin Powers crossover. They were really good tracks, and I'd say the Nursey, as I like to call it, is one of the most beautiful songs I've heard in a while, and it's really high up there. Expectations are high. And of course, I want the whole, because I've downloaded it, I want the whole album to be awesome, you know. So I was ready, willing to go. So it opens up, and instantly, because the way my mind works and my musical tastes, I had visions of Brian Eno and Daniel Lenoir fiddling at the master keyboards. This sounded like a track from the Unforgettable Fire album by U2. That soundscape, the dreamy stuff. All it was missing was the Edge guitar, ding, 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 going over the top, you know. But the main sort of sauce on the pizza was definitely Unforgettable Fire sort of ilk, which I found really interesting.
Yeah.
Because I don't know if it's deliberate or not, but that sort of point of reference was very unexpected for me. That sound.
When you're, especially when you're applying it to Keenan and like what you think are his musical sensibilities, kind of a dark dude. You're talking about U2, which is like a really bright band. Quite positive usually. And
I mean, it was just really whether it's meant to be or not, that's what it brought up to me. And those sort of, you know, it's just wonderful. It was a dreamy sort of landscapey type sound, you know, that they create, and that's the genius particularly of Eno, but also Lenoir. They're really interesting. And then it starts, and I use the word, and I apologize to the people who watched the reaction, I used the word intricate about 18 times. but The guitars, I thought, were very intricate.
Ah,
but they were clever guitars that it was almost dappling bits of sunlight over the main melody. It was really, and if you stopped and really without, you know, just listened to 20 seconds of the song without listening to the whole thing, you could almost think that it's like Swiss cheese. There are holes in it because it's not a full sound, but it all makes sense and comes together. So it is a full sound, but not in a traditional way. Do you know what I mean?
Of course.
These are just my impressions, and my notes are a bit over the place because, I thought the drumming was absolutely fantastic. It wasn't intricate. It was precise. It wasn't showy, but it was really intelligent sort of, rather than doing sort of like firework fills, you know, at the end of phrases, whatever, it was just changing different patterns and the way the sort of timing went. It was really clever. And I think perhaps some people, it would just skate over them, but I noticed it and I really appreciated it. I thought it was really, really clever. So it starts off, and I think I said in the reaction, again, my Achilles heel, words, lyrics to songs, which, you know, is why I give you so many instrumentals. I always thought I was like, this, you know, reacting to music, especially with yourself, I never realized how much I gloss over words. And even if they go in and stick and I can sing the song words back to you, there's only a handful of bands where I really dive into the meanings, or it was so apparent, or the mood is there. I think the music comes first to me and then the words second, if you know what I mean. So that all said, I did catch some of them. And it starts off with something like, and I did write some scribblings down again. A usual disclaimer, these may or may not be accurate. You know, your home is at risk if you do not keep up repayments. But so glad to see you well. Something. No, I can't make that out. And completely silent now. And this is the bit that's, I don't know if this is all. It says something about, that's it. Heaven's help, cast your demons out. And then it goes on about your halo around your neck. And then he says there's something about off your cloud as well. And I'm more than a little curious how you're planning to go about making your amends to the dead. Pause. To the dead. And that's what, just there, I had a little moment of clarity, which is probably not clarity at all, and just mine. But what it triggered in my mind was knowing the title of the album and certain subjects so far that we heard, 13th Step, etc. You're so well, overcome, heaven's help, make amends. I was thinking AA meeting. That's what it, you know. And then I just thought, make amends to the dead. That's quite a heavy thing. And I instantly went to someone, where there's a drunk driver who mowed someone down. That was my idea straight away. I don't know how, it doesn't really matter if it's true or not, but it's just really, you know, again, he has some great sort of image inspiring lyrics. You know, he's a clever guy, I've said it before. And at that point, it goes into a bit and then it switches. The sound quality actually changes from this dreamy state. It's like, and suddenly it's clear and in your face. And it's not in your face, sorry, but it's a lot clearer and closer as well. And the bass comes front and center really strongly in it. And that I thought was I've written down my notes, sorry. Yeah. The sound switches from the dreamy quality of the first verse after the second to the dead. It becomes much clearer and closer. The best. Yeah, so it brings it to you almost. And I don't know if it's like this. I don't know what choice, why he made that choice. Because it's deliberate. Zebra, and obviously, unless they had some dodgy tape, they don't, it's digital now, I know. But he made that choice, whether it's like a musical version of A Moment of Clarity.
Yeah.
Which is what we talk about, you know. And then from then on, I was just listening to the guitar and the drums because I thought they were both brilliant. And, you know, I'll use this word again, intricate. But it was... It was also like picking melodies out that weren't really there. And it was just really clever. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was, it demands repeat listening is what I put, because yeah. I didn't get as much out of it as I could have done in the first listening. And then he starts going into there's a nice little mini build up, and then it goes, your halo slipping down lines, the big sound arrives, you know, and there's these crashing guitars, and there's a nice little line with a guitar in the right channel going, you know, and I really like that. And then it's sort of this crashing comes to a sort of end, and then there's a soft take out to it, and that's as much as I got, and it was a lot, to be honest with you. I think I was a little bit overwhelmed by it because it was a lot in there, even though it doesn't seem like there's a lot in there, there really was. But overall, I absolutely loved it, and I would say I loved it more than Blue, but still not quite as much as Nursey.
Okay, because
that was just so beautiful, but it's really, really good. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, that's awesome to hear. This is probably my second favorite song on the album. I don't know why. I guess I just must have been in the mood for Blue, or thought that Blue was a safer pick for you. I do love Blue. It's like probably my third or fourth favorite.
It's a decent song, yeah.
But this, I love the imagery. I love the idea of your halo, the thing that makes you great being the thing that brings you down.
I did wonder, he said it a lot about the halo slipping down. The way he starts off and talks, I almost feel like the halo as in, you know, sainthood, whatever. But it feels like it's a self-imposed halo that the person's put it there themselves rather than they've earned it.
Yes.
And that's why it could slip down, because you wouldn't talk in those, you know, religious terms that somebody else, you know, has a halo.
Or if your halo is built from your nature's fragility, should you really be going around beating your chest? Like the thing that built the redemption song was based on your fall. Like, do you really want to fly that close to the sun and have an ego about coming back from something when you were so close to the precipice? Like, so you're right. 13th step. We've talked about it before. This song is almost a concept album about addiction and recovery and the different stages that you go through and steps you take to get through it. And what I think an interesting blurb is, the lyrics were inspired by a meeting attended by Keenan in which a speaker discussed the tendency of others in recovery to be unfairly self-righteous. He mentioned something about, this is a quote from Keenan. He mentioned about something about not letting your halo choke you to death when it slips down around your neck. So I grabbed my pencil and I wrote that down. And I told Billy I had an idea for a song. It's a really powerful thing for a person to come back. This is another quote from Maynard James Keenan. It's a really powerful thing for a person to come back from the edge of death and work their way back to being a human again. Those people are very impressive survivors, but some of them tend to wear that as some kind of crown and forget about the atrocities they committed. And you talked about the allusion to the dead in the lyrics, and perhaps it is quite literally the dead, like maybe you gave so-and-so, you got them high and they overdosed, or on your shit, or something to, like you said, the drunk driver, like maybe you killed someone in a manslaughter car accident situation when you were drunk. There's also those that are dead to you, or you are dead to, like, how are you, like, because of the lifestyle,
you know
what I mean? Like, we're dead. You're dead
advertised,
when you stole from me, or when you lied to me for the last time. So there's this, I think, some creative liberty you can take with what the dead means when he's saying that line. But let me run through the lyrics and kind of patch in where you may have missed some stuff or whatever.
Can I just interject? I mean, this is purely from a personal point of view, but I'm not as, I mean, the AA in this country is a car rescue service.
That's our AAA.
Yeah. I'm sure it, you know, is here, but I don't think it's quite as prominent as it may be in the USA.
Yeah.
That's my guess. And I mean, I had a family member who was, you know, 14 carat alcoholic, and he didn't make it through. And it was a very slow, I mean, he died in his late 50s, late 50s, probably. And it was a long time coming. It was a 30-year crash, you know. Yeah. And bit by bit, he took apart his own family as well, and his kids and his wife. And, you know, I absolutely adored him because he was charming, funny, and he was a guy with a big heart. But we didn't see the other side. He was an absolute, not a monster, but, you know, just this selfish bastard who caused pain.
Just destructive.
Yeah. And not even meaning to be, but just was.
Oh, yeah. That's sometimes the saddest and worst part, you know?
Yeah, in the grip of it, you know? And when he got the sort of the death knock from his doctor, he did actually manage to retie some sort of relationship with his kids in the last 6 months, which was, you know, it was cool. It was just interesting. You said about that, you know, the dead and the severed ties, because, yeah, I kind of saw that, and he managed to do it, but that's only because he was, you know, going within months, as opposed to this, where you say, I survived, and, you know, I'm great again. Yeah, how the hell could you then retie those severed links with people that you fucked over, and you probably didn't mean to, you know, intentionally, but if you're in the grip of whatever, that's what matters.
Yeah, how clear is your vision to interpret those situations anyway? You know what I mean? When you're that deep into it. So,
yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah. So glad to see you well. Overcome them. Completely silent now. With heaven's help, you cast your demons out. So, yeah, like, you've overcome your demons. They're completely silent now. And not to pull your halo down around your neck and tug you off your cloud, but I'm more than just a little curious how you're planning to go about making your amends to the dead. To the dead. Recall the deeds as if they're all someone else's atrocious stories.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Like, you're divorcing yourself from the fact that you were doing this. Like, this is part of who you are. Don't, you know, don't let your soapbox or your high horse be too tall. Someone else's atrocious stories. Now you stand reborn before us all. So glad to see you well. And not to pull your halo down around your neck and tug you to the ground, but I'm more than just a little curious how you're planning to go about making your amends to the dead, to the dead. With your halo slipping down, your halo slipping, your halo slipping down, your halo slipping down, your halo slipping down. With your halo slipping down, and I'm more than just, and this is where they overlap that lyrical part, which I love when that's in a song, like the, your halo, I'm more than just a little, they overlap. I'm more than just a little curious how you're planning to go about making your amends. With your halo slipping down, I'm more than just a little curious how you're planning to go about making your amends. With your halo slipping down, and I'm more than just a little curious how you're planning to go about making your amends. And it repeats until your halo slipping down, your halo slipping down to choke you now. And then that's how the song ends. Yeah, it's like a kind of remember where you came from and how you got here sort of situation. And it's It's interesting that you brought up like the change in because I think that the band, not just Maynard, are like geniuses when it comes to playing with sound dynamics and how sound dynamics can capture mood. And there is this out of focus sound in the beginning. And then when the message, like when it gets less like, I'm glad to see you well, you've cast your demons out, hey, good for you. When the message becomes far more stark, and you know, it's the part after we always say something really nice, but this is like the part that is the part after the but of the song is when it becomes so stark musically that it slaps you in the face, like the reminder that it is. And I think that that's just a really genius way of doing it. Super cool that you noticed that. Super smart that you picked up on that as well. Even if you didn't fully correlate it, you noticed that musical difference on one listen. So that's really cool. And just something that like when you can really dig this far into a song, it's not just, you know, on the surface level, you dig deep and continue to find gems and gold and all these different things. It's a really joyous experience for me. It's so fulfilling for whatever reason, but I'm glad this was we're 3 for 3 now. I'm tempted to give you another one, but I'm also just want to let you off your leash for crying out loud. You've got the album, but there'll probably be, regardless of how we attack it, there'll probably be more Maynard in some way, shape or form on the channel. And I'm just super glad that you like this. So anything you want to add before I, you and I have discussed the band before, you know who the folks are in it and you know, so. But anything you want to say?
Yeah, before I think probably the only thing, and this is not to be overly critical of the institution, AA, but I mean, it focuses a lot, it's religiously driven. I think if it helps people, that's fine, but I am uncomfortable with organized religion. It's really not for me. I think some of the main tenets behind it are fine, you know. Love your neighbor, don't steal, don't kill. These are all groovy things we can get behind. But other stuff, don't put a condom on because you're killing things and all that. That's somebody's made up belief, and you know, you shouldn't force that on anyone. And I think the thing helping people get over their addictions is great. And there's lots of people that do, you know, and institutions that do it. I think this sort of, you know, I can't remember the speech itself. But somebody, I recognize that, you know, the Lord is my savior and helpless without him and all this sort of thing. And it's, I could see how someone who comes through the other side of this, you know, 12-step process, there's that added sort of piety to it, which I think is this element of this on, you know, being above yourself and your high horse when you've done all this crap. Mm-hmm. I think it adds to it. And that may be one of the sort of the threads he's pulling at
there. Yeah. You know, which is funny because uses a lot of religious imagery in this.
Yeah.
You know, which the halo and pulling you off the cloud and heaven's help and, you know.
Yeah, exactly. Which, you know, he's done deliberately
because
it'll piss those people off even more.
And it helps his argument. Like it gives his argument, you know, it makes it hold water more, and he's using mechanisms that would resonate with the audience he's aiming it at. So so many writers have done that in the past. Martin Luther King was one of the greatest writers of being able to convey his argument to the weak spots or the chinks in the armor of those he were his adversaries, but who needed to hear his message. There's some of like nowhere near as powerful or whatever, but there's that element to this where, you know, you're throwing it back at the individual, but so glad you liked it once again. Everybody out there in the audiophiles listening audience, if you're a fan or if you're new to this, whatever your perspective, like, dislike, what have you, please feel free to share it. We love interacting with you guys. The conversation doesn't necessarily have to stop with the end of the video. That's sort of the beauty of this and kind of the main reason why we're doing all this stuff. It's just kind of a nerdy book club for music here at the audiophiles. So thank you so much for being part of it. And I hope you continue to join, like, share, subscribe, all the fun stuff. That being out of the way, John, thank you so much. And we will see you guys on the next episode of The Audiophiles.